Come thou incarnate word, gird on thy mighty sword, our prayer attend, come and thy people bless, and give thy word success, Spirit of holiness, on us descend. In your Bibles, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 beginning through verse 4, all one sentence. Reading tonight from the New King James Version of the Bible. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels, as he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Psalm 1:8 and also verse 9 says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Several years ago, a man named George Goodman wrote this, that the name of Jesus is the widest known and best loved, indeed the most outstanding name in the world, not even the bitterest opponent can deny. Its praises are sung without ceasing day and night. From every quarter of the globe ascend songs of gladness from the lips of those whose lives have been lightened with the knowledge of that name. It is in very fact the name that is above every name. The press never stops printing books and tracts of which he is the theme. Poets sing his praise in sacred poetry and in solemn hymns. Artists find inspiration in the incidents in his life and death for their greatest masterpieces. Daily, tens of thousands of teachers and preachers go forth, often asking no reward, to proclaim his name and speak of his dying love. Martyrs triumphed in the flames or endured patiently in dungeons, and unnumbered hosts have suffered the loss of all things for the love of his name, desiring only the privilege of spending and being sent for his sake. Our text says that he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Rotherham translates the word excellent, distinguished. The New International Version has superior. And the New Testament in basic English reads a more noble name. In his work on Greek words, Thayer says that excellent means surpassing. In fact, the 20th century New Testament translates our text, the name that he has inherited surpasses theirs. Whose? The angels. Jesus' name is more excellent than the angels. The name of God's Son, his only begotten Son, is surpassing and superior to any and all names of angels that may be known, but we only know of three in Scripture, Gabriel and Michael and Lucifer. Obviously, the name of Jesus surpasses Lucifer, but it also transcends the names of Gabriel and Michael. Now, notice how the Son of God himself, not just his name, but his person, is exalted far above all angels. If you keep reading in the text, verse 5 through 13, for to which of the angels did he ever say, you are my son, today I have begotten you? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. But when he again brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all the angels of God worship him. And of the angels, he says, who makes his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But to the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. Amen. a scepter of righteousness in the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. And you, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will grow old like a garment, like a cloak. You will fold them up, and they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years will not fail. But to which of the angels has he ever said, "Sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool"? So you can see that not just the name, but the very person and the work of Christ is far superior to that of angels. Now our text says that Christ has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. The Bible speaks of several things that we will inherit someday. I found at least seven in Scripture. The meek shall inherit the earth. We shall inherit eternal life if we have left all for his name's sake. The kingdom that was prepared for us, we shall inherit someday. The kingdom of God is something that those who participate and practice and make a practice of certain sins will not inherit, but we shall. We shall inherit salvation. We shall inherit a blessing. We shall inherit the water of life. These are seven biblical things that you and I, as children of God, can look forward to being part of our inheritance. But the text tonight says that Jesus inherited a more excellent name. This inheritance had to come from the Father. Just as the 12 sons of Israel received their inheritance from their father. That's how inheritance works. The Bible says in Hebrews 1 and verse 2, in the Amplified New Testament, whom he appointed heir and lawful owner of all things. Jesus Christ is the God-anointed, God-appointed heir of everything. And if you read on in chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, as the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus Christ was faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses was faithful to his appointment. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 4 and 5 in the Amplified. One does not appropriate for himself the honor of being high priest, but he is called by God and receives it of him, just as Aaron did. So too, Christ the Messiah did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed and exalted by him who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." Jesus is not only more excellent than the angels and has a name more excellent than theirs, but he is also more excellent than any human being who has lived on this earth, and his name is far above any human name that has ever been exalted. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made of himself no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Now notice, therefore, in view of what he has just said, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven, and those on earth, and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now the Bible tells us that a good name is more desirable than great riches, Proverbs 22 and verse 1. Lord Francis Jeffrey said, A good name, like goodwill, is got by many actions and lost by only one. If I mention the name Shoeless Joe Jackson, does that ring a bell with anyone? He was a great baseball player for the Chicago White Sox. But in 1919, he and seven of his team members conspired to throw the World Series. And when he emerged from the courthouse following the trial, a little boy cried out, "Say it ain't so, Joe." No one will ever have to say it ain't so, Jesus, because he is so far above everyone else, not only in his name, but in the purity of his life, that his name can never be lost by one bad action. There are several names in Scripture that cast a tremendously long shadow. Think about this. The name of Abram, or Abraham, according to the Blue Letter Bible, appears some 285 times in your Bible. The name of Moses appears 848 times. These are long shadows cast by great names. But the name of David appears 1,085 times. When you go into the New Covenant Scriptures, you will find the name of Peter, sometimes called Cephas, 168 times. You will find the name of Paul, previously known as Saul of Tarsus, 189 times. But you will find the name of Jesus, or its equivalent, Jesus Christ, Lord Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus, some 1,600 times. But it is not just in Scripture that Jesus heads the list. George Bancroft said, "I find the name of Jesus Christ written on the top of every page of modern history." You see, Jesus is a name that came straight from heaven. An angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, telling him not to be afraid to take Mary as his wife because she was with child by the Holy Spirit. And the angel said, "She will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." You know that the name Jesus is the Greek form of the Hebrew name Joshua, which means Jehovah is salvation. The first Joshua saved his people, Israel, with the help of God. But since Jesus is God in the flesh, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him. Hebrews 7, verse 25. Joshua led his people to the promised land, but Jesus can lead all who accept him as Lord all the way to paradise, to heaven. But didn't Isaiah say that the Son of God would be called Emmanuel, which means God with us? Indeed, he did. Emmanuel is his prophetic name, and Jesus is his personal name. However, there are as many as 700 different names and titles of Jesus in the Bible. Most people called him Jesus, but the disciples who knew him the best and were with him the most never once called him Jesus in their personal conversations. They always addressed him out of respect as Lord or Master or Teacher or Christ. Many of you know Maxine Freem Gash. I wrote an article not too long ago called "They Never Called Him Jesus." And she wrote back to me, agreeing with me and saying, "I think it's because there was a dignity about his bearing that did not invite undue familiarity." Is that an amazing thought or not, that they never called him Jesus? I wanted to put this up as a PowerPoint, but we're not doing that tonight. But these are something I put together not long ago called 12 Interesting Facts Concerning Names and Titles of Jesus. Number one, the most common name for Jesus in the Gospels is Jesus. The most common name in the book of Acts, however, is Lord. The most common name in the epistles is Christ. The most common name used by Jesus of himself, Son of Man. The most common name used by God of his Son, as you might expect, My Beloved Son. The most common name used by others, Lord. The shortest name or title, I Am. The longest name or title, get ready for this, 10 words, the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus. Number nine, there are names from nature, such as Balm of Gilead, Branch of Righteousness, Lily of the Valleys, Rose of Sharon, Tender Plant, True Vine. Number 10, there are heavenly names, Bright and Morning Star, Day Star, Light of the World, Star out of Jacob, Son of Righteousness. Number 11, there are even names of animals, Lamb and Lion of Judah. And number 12, there are names of inanimate objects such as Banner to the People, Chief Cornerstone, Door of the Sheep, Foundation Laid in Zion, Horn of Salvation, Rock, Scepter, Stone. This could not be said of any other person in the world that there would be that many different names said about this one man. But you know, the name of Jesus, though we welcome it here tonight, is not welcome everywhere. Several years ago, out in Nevada, officials at a Nevada high school unplugged the microphone on valedictorian Brittany McComb when she tried to attribute her academic success to Jesus Christ, and they pulled the mic on her. The name of Jesus was not welcome in that high school. School officials at the College of William and Mary removed a cross from the front of the chapel in the Sir Christopher Wren building to make the chapel more welcoming to people of other faiths. Washington Governor Chris Gregory lit a menorah in the state capitol of Washington, but a nativity scene honoring Jesus was forbidden. A recent federal court ruling that prohibits prayers invoked in the name of Jesus in the Indiana House was accomplished. And a Navy chaplain went on an 18-day fast because he was not allowed to pray in the name of Jesus. He's a Christian chaplain. What else could he possibly pray? Whose name could he pray in? But he was forbidden to do so and went on an 18-day fast to protest this. The Apostle Peter, in attributing the healing of a lame man to the power of Jesus, boldly declared in Acts 4 and verse 12, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." No other name in the world has such authority and power. No other name in the world has such ability to heal and to comfort and to save. No other name of any church leader or Bible teacher, past or present, should receive hero worship other than Jesus Christ. Amen. Life in His name is offered to those who believe that Jesus is the Christ. Repentance and forgiveness of sins was to be preached in His name in all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. And in that city, on the day of Pentecost, the birthday of the church, Peter instructed his inquirers to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins. And they would receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would be sent by the Father in my name. Even a cup of cold water given to someone in Jesus' name will assure us of our eternal reward in heaven, according to Mark 9 and verse 41. Salvation is the greatest need of humanity, and it is forever and always will be linked with the name of Jesus.
Amen.
There are 12 names and titles of Jesus in the Bible that are directly related to salvation. Number one, he is the atoning sacrifice. 1 John 2, verse 2. Number two, he is the captain of our what? Our salvation, Hebrews 2 and verse 10. Number three, he is the deliverer, Romans 11, verse 26. Number four, he is the fountain filled with blood, Zechariah 13, 1. Number five, he is the great high priest, Hebrews 4, verse 14. Of course, he is Jesus, whose name means salvation, Matthew 1, 21. Number seven, he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, John 1, 29. Number eight, he is the mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, 1 Timothy 2 and verse 5. Number nine, he is our Passover, 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7. Number 10, he is our ransom, 1 Timothy 2, verse 6. Number 11, he is our Redeemer. Job knew this long before the cross, Job 19, verse 25. And number 12, he is our Savior, Luke 2 and verse 11. Apart from his name, there is no salvation anywhere.
Amen.
Archibald Alexander testified, "All my theology is reduced to this narrow compass. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners." That's what it all comes down to. Did you know that you can now officially name a star in the International Star Registry? For $50, you can name a star after a friend or a loved one. You'll receive a nice certificate with the name of the star, the constellation in which it is found, and the location of the star circled in red. But thousands of years ago, Almighty God circled in red a star named Jesus. Listen to Numbers 24, verse 17. "I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel." Charles Spurgeon said of Jesus, "In darkness, he is my star, and in brightness, he is my sin." Jesus is the star that outshines all stars. His name is far above all names, King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Amen.
But it was his humiliation that brought his exaltation. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, but it didn't come cheap. It was the death of the cross that caused his name to be lifted up in every nation. Several years ago, IntelliQuest listed the world's 100 greatest people. I don't have time to read all the names on the list, but this was according to IntelliQuest. The world's 100 greatest people: Alexander the Great, Buddha, Charlemagne, Darwin, Edison, Einstein, Freud, Gandhi, Handel, Lincoln, Luther, Marx, Muhammad, Napoleon, Rembrandt, Shakespeare, Tolstoy, Voltaire, Washington, and Jesus was listed right along with the rest. But Jesus is not just one of 100 great names. God says the name of his Son is transcendent. That is, it is above all other names for all time and all eternity. Not only it is transcendent, it is triumphant. Not only it is triumphant, his name literally towers infinitely far above all others. And here are 10 reasons why. Only Jesus Christ of Nazareth, of this list of 100, only Jesus was born of a virgin.
Amen.
Only Jesus filled not just a few, but hundreds of biblical prophecies, fulfilling 33 in one day alone, the day he died on the cross. Only Jesus lived not just a good life, but a perfect life, a sinless life. Only Jesus taught absolute truth. Others taught remarkable truths for their day, but Jesus taught absolute truth. Only Jesus could perform matchless miracles. They've never been matched by anyone anywhere. Only Jesus died a sacrificial, substitutionary, vicarious, those are big words, but you can go home and look them up, an atoning death. For no man would dare to say that his death would atone for the sins of others except for Jesus. Only Jesus arose bodily from the grave and appeared to many following his resurrection. Only Jesus ascended into heaven. Only Jesus intercedes for us daily. And only Jesus is returning a second time in power and glory. George Goodman, who I quoted to start this message with, said this: consider the dignity of his person, the sinlessness of his life, the nobility of his death, the purity of his teaching, the glory of his resurrection, the wonder of his salvation, and his glory today as head of the church. He has a name that is surpassing all angels, greater than any human, and we could even say those in the spirit world, and I won't give much time to this, but if you go back to Philippians 2 with me in verse 10 and 11, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. At the name of Jesus, the name above all others, every being, celestial beings, and we've talked about them, the angelic beings, terrestrial beings, that's you and me, human beings, and subterrestrial beings, the spirit world, and I don't know that we know the names of those spirits. We would know the names of the spirits who have just been made perfect because Hebrews 11 lists a whole bunch of them. But these are those who are under the earth, and I don't think they're under the earth anymore. I think they're in paradise, where Christ took them when he emptied out paradise. But they will all bow before him, and they will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now, millions of martyrs, and that number is growing every day, and legions who are still living have made that same confession that I made on the 20th of June, 1958, as I stood on the shores of Pine Lake Bible Camp in Eldora, Iowa. I was only 12 years old, but I knew what I was confessing. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. I've staked my eternal destiny on that confession, that good confession, and I know that you have too, just as millions of martyrs and legions still living have done so. So I gladly confess with Peter that I do believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And I do sing with Edward Perronet, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem, and crown him Lord of all. And ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall, hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. And let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. I found this in some notes that my father left when he left 3 years ago for that better land. And it's not written by him, but it was in his notes, so it's important to me. And it's simply called The Cosmopolitan Christ. To the artist, Jesus is the one altogether lovely. To the architect, he is the chief cornerstone. To the astronomer, he is the Son of Righteousness, risen with healing in his wings. To the baker, he is the living bread. To the banker, he is the hidden treasure. To the biologist, he is the life. To the builder, he is the sure foundation. To the carpenter, he is the door. To the doctor, he is the great physician. To the educator, he is the great teacher. To the engineer, he is the new and living way. To the farmer, he is the sower and the Lord of the harvest. To the florist, he is the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valleys. To the geologist, he is the rock of ages. To the horticulturist, he is the true vine. To the judge, he is the righteous judge, the judge of all men. To the juror, he is the faithful and true witness. To the jeweler, he is the pearl of great price. To the lawyer, he is the counselor, the lawgiver, the advocate. To the newspaper man, he is the good tidings of great joy. To the oculist, he is the light of the eyes. To the philanthropist, he is the wisdom of God. To the preacher, he is the word of God. To the sculptor, he is the living stone. To the servant, he is the good master. To the student, he is the incarnate truth. To the statesman, he is the desire of all nations. To the theologian, he is the author and finisher of our faith. To the weary toiler, he is the giver of rest. And to the sinner, he is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Surely his name is greater than all other names, and let's give him praise and glory for that tonight. Amen. Amen.